Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Rogue Angel by Alex Archer. Narrated by Nanette Savard. With performances by Colleen Delany, Richard Rowan, James Konicek, Kimberly Gilbert, Matthew Bassett, Stephen Carpenter, Allison Thomas, Bradley Smith, Christopher Sheeren, Danny Gavigan, David Coyne, Elizabeth Jernigan, Eric Messner, Evan Casey, Jonathan Watkins, Ken Jackson, Michael John Casey, Nanette Savard, Mort Shelby, Rose Elizabeth Supan, Nick DePinto, Nora Achrati, Thomas Keegan, Tim Getman, and Yasmin Twazan. Rogue Angel 39, City of Swords.
His arrow struck deep in the deer's chest, but missed the heart. The animal struggled to get up, tangling itself in the tall grass. Dragging one leg, the man limped toward it. Though always a heavily built man, sturdy, he preferred to think of himself, he used to get around effortlessly. But age had taken its toll, coupled with the fevers that had plagued him these past few months. His doctors demanded he avoid roast meat. Who were they to tell a king what to do? Boiled venison was not so tasty, and he intended to savor a properly prepared roast tonight. Charlemagne drew his sword, the blade catching the late afternoon sun and taking on a molten cast. He couldn't stand to see the animal suffer. One slash across the throat finished the deer.
This sword, my friend, has already killed a great many men.
Two of his men dragged the deer back to Charlemagne's home. Charlemagne cleaned his blade first, then bathed and dressed for dinner, wearing a linen shirt against his skin and matching breeches. Over this, he wore a dark tunic trimmed with a pale silk fringe, the one bit of finery he allowed himself. He preferred to dress like a commoner, leaving aside all but one jeweled ring he wore. Lastly, he put on ivory hose and comfortable shoes. Charlemagne left the room, but returned to check himself in the mirror. There were guests to consider tonight, and he wanted to appear well-groomed. Despite his years, he remained good-looking. His hair was white, but there was an abundance of it. He arranged the curls with his fingers, squared his shoulders, pronounced himself acceptable, and went downstairs. Among the dinner guests he was about to greet was his son Louis, whom he had recently crowned. It would be good to see him again and to speak of politics and alliances. No doubt someone would ask to hear tales from one of his great battles. Charlemagne had been engaged in one clash after another throughout nearly all his reign, usually at the front of his bodyguard squadrons. But sometimes alone, when there was no one to bear witness. Always with his sword, Joyeuse, in hand. Charlemagne patted the scabbard. 3 decades of fighting, more than a dozen wars, and now this sword was relegated to putting a deer out of its misery. Perhaps he would regale those gathered with that final push he'd orchestrated to conquer Saxonia and to convert the barbarians to Christianity. It was a good story, and he didn't mind retelling it. Then he would excuse himself and retire early, as he planned to venture out again at first light. A few more days of hunting, then he would travel to Aachen, given the onset of November. He'd come to enjoy hunting animals far more than he'd ever enjoyed hunting men. Charlemagne's plans to return to the hunt in the spring would never materialize, as he would fall ill with pleurisy.
Oh.
He took to his bed a final time.
Joyeuse, ma sword.
A servant placed the sword at his side. Charlemagne wrapped his thick fingers around the pommel. This sword, his one constant companion, gave him some measure of peace.
Joyeuse, my very dear friend.
Charlemagne died. The sword was Annja Creed's one constant companion. It was a yard of double-bladed steel, honed impossibly sharp. Though a priceless relic, it was not a showpiece suited to a museum. It was a dealer of death, her servant and master, good fortune and wretched curse. Once belonging to Joan of Arc, shattered and mysteriously reformed, it had come to Annja, along with a destiny to wield it wisely. Annja was in France for a two-part segment for Chasing History's Monsters. Her TV show's producers were really scraping the bottom of the barrel for legends to sensationalize. The past 4 days had taken Annja and her cameraman under the city to the famous Paris catacombs. It was familiar ground for Annja, who'd explored the chambers where long-buried skeletons were stashed to make room for more bodies in the city's overcrowded cemeteries. The tunnels under Paris had a fascinating and rich history, most of which had already been done to death on TV. Anya's assignment had been to find something fresh. A skilled archaeologist, Annja certainly had an affinity for ruins. Even so, it was tough to get excited about this assignment. She hadn't wanted to come to France. It was a place of nightmares for her. Joan of Arc had been lashed to a pillar in the Vieux Marché in Rouen and burned at the stake in 1431. After her horrible death, her body was burned a second time, and then a third, the ashes scattered into the Seine. Annja was somehow connected to the holy martyr, and her sleep on occasion was cut through with fiery images. But while France held nightmares for her, it was also a paycheck, at least this week. Annja had finished her work shortly before 5 today, showered, dressed in the only couture outfit she'd brought to the city, and took her cameraman to Pierre Gagnard's in the 8th District for fish terrine. Annja had come alone to this train platform, looking for a fight. She needed the exercise to burn off some of the evening's rich meal, but something else compelled her, an unidentifiable itch to be scratched. This wasn't the first inexplicable tugging she'd felt to do something, and Annja had just learned not to question it. Familiar with Paris, she knew to avoid Les Halles, Le Châtelet, and Gare du Nord this late at night, when the crowds had disappeared. So that's precisely where she'd ventured. Les Halles and Le Châtelet yielded no opponents, but Gare du Nord and its shadowy side streets brought out this fellow and his now absent friends. Tourists traveling alone around the old train station were warned to keep a low profile and to avoid wearing jewelry that might entice thieves, but Annja had done the opposite. In the sequin-trimmed cocktail dress she'd worn earlier to dinner, emerald necklace dangling in the low V of the fabric, Annja had trolled back and forth like a fisherman after bass. And sure enough, she managed to attract the attention of some young thugs, one of them more than willing to give her the fight she'd hoped for. This ruffian thought he'd have the upper hand, armed with his switchblade, but was unpleasantly surprised when Annja called forth her sword from the otherwhere. The lights from the train station were diffused by the thin fog and distorted the blade so it looked like a ribbon of darkened silver. The switchblade he wielded was no match for her sword. He should have fled as his two companions had moments ago, but he stood there, puffing himself up with the bravado of youth. Annja swung the sword above her head in a flashy move meant to rattle her less skilled opponent.
Fight fair.
All right, I'll fight you on equal terms.
With a thought, she dismissed the sword, relegating it to the otherwhere where it hung, waiting for her to summon it again. Her opponent glanced quickly at the ground and into the shadows. Not spotting the sword, he returned his full attention to her.
You witch!
Annja crouched to meet his charge. He didn't disappoint her, darting in and slashing forward. Annja sidestepped and brought up her foot, catching his ankle. He stumbled, but managed to keep his balance. He whirled toward her, eyes narrowed.
Bitch!
Such language.
Fuck off! I'll throw you to the dogs.
No, I'll throw you to the police.
From his accent, Annja guessed that the fellow was probably from one of the Roma camps. France had declared war against the illegal encampments that had sprung up around Paris, evacuating many of the immigrants living there. But the Romani were entrenched. Paris news agencies had been reporting on the itinerant gangs, preying on travelers arriving from London on the high-speed trains. Now, Annja was preying on one of those gang members. He shuffled to his right, putting his back to an old stone wall and tossing the knife into his other hand, trying to rattle her. Annja waited for him to make the next move. He came at her, this time stabbing at her side.
What?
Then he wheeled and darted at her again. His sudden move managed to slice her dress. Annja cursed herself for underestimating the youth. A street brawler, yes, but somewhere along the line, he'd had training. She appraised him more carefully. The sleeves of his shirt were tight around his biceps, suggesting muscles. His calves were thick, too. Certainly not the common ruffian she'd originally considered him to be. As he came forward and jabbed at her, then shuffled back, she realized his moves were those of a boxer.
You might make a better opponent than I thought.
Cocksucking bitch!
Sticks and stones.
He pointed the knife tip at her throat and made a gesture with his free hand.
Yes, I gathered that you want my necklace. I'm rather fond of it. A gift from an old friend.
The thug continued to come at her, jumping in and back, swinging his knife and alternately punching with his free hand. He didn't connect with anything, but he also didn't give up. Annja moved out of his way each time, kept him close, not wanting to discourage him. She was in heels, and the spikes caught in the cracks of the brick, threatening to topple her. It would have been easier to slip out of them, but she didn't want easy tonight.
Die, you bitch!
No, I'm not gonna die tonight. But neither will you. We're just playing, aren't we? Like children looking to run off a little steam? Having fun, you little prick.
He sped up his rushes, sweeping the blade in a wider and wider arc, his anger making his moves more erratic and easier to dodge.
Go to hell!
Not tonight.
He jockeyed for position, which allowed her to step onto the sidewalk, easier on her heels.
Damn you!
Then Annja took the initiative. She stepped in and thumped him on the chest with her open hand. Finally, he was showing signs of fatigue, but he still wasn't giving up, his predatory gaze lingering on the emerald necklace.
The man who gave me this said it was 400 years old, give or take a decade. Worth as much for its historic value as for the gems. You'd probably fence it for a few cases of Alizé Bleu.
The combat had managed to wash away her fatigue. Maybe it was time to call it a night. Her opponent took a few steps back and cocked his head, listening. Annja listened, too. The approaching footsteps announced the return of the Hood's companions. They'd brought help. Altogether, there were 7 of them.
Now you're fucked, you dirty whore.
Annja felt for the sword in her mind, but waited. She delivered a roundhouse kick to her dancing partner, her pointed heel jabbing his stomach. He doubled over and dropped the switchblade. Annja kicked him once more, angling higher and pounding her foot against his chest. He slumped to his knees. She administered a quick neck chop, which rendered him unconscious. Then she devoted her attention to the remaining 6.
You will die for that!
The tallest one brandished a gun and pulled the trigger. The bullet came close, passing where Anya's head had been a heartbeat before. On reflex, she ducked just as he'd reached into his jacket pocket. Annja rolled forward, deliberately losing her shoes and coming up in a crouch. Don't bring a knife to a gunfight, or in her case, a sword. Still, in her mind, she touched the blade, seeking its reassuring presence. Annja took one glance at the gang. Then she slipped to where the shadows were thickest along the wall. The patchy fog and darkness made the men seem even more menacing. The tallest gang member was well over 6 feet, thin, but with broad shoulders, like a dagger that had been jammed tip first into the street. He was in the front, 2 each to his right and left, back a few feet. So the guy she'd fought moments ago wasn't the gang leader. The others were all of similar build to the tall one with the gun, and all had the oddly cropped and spiky hair their unconscious fellow sported. A 6th held back. He also had a gun with a silencer. That they had guns with silencers marked them as a notch above a common gang. The guns were probably stolen. The newcomers scanned the area, taking in the guy she'd knocked out.
Well, I didn't quite bargain for this now, did I? Me and my impulses.
One of the men moved his arms to his sides, showing that he had a length of chain for a weapon. The other 3 produced switchblades, 1 in each hand.
Girl, come out where we can get a better look at you. We won't hurt you.
Much.
Annja felt their eyes on her. They knew exactly where she was. She also sensed other eyes on her. Another gang member?
Come out, girl! Girl, come out.
Come out, wherever you are.
She did just that. In a blur of taupe taffeta, chiffon, and sequins, Annja surprised both gunmen who couldn't draw a bead. She slammed into the lead one, striking his throat with her elbow. Annja grabbed his gun with her other hand, throwing it behind her. She pulled her 2nd elbow jab, not wanting to kill him. Annja had to crouch to duck the chain now swinging her way. 5 left standing. Make that 4. Almost too easy.
sound!
The other man with the gun glared at her. He was older than the others, with a short beard and a dead eye.
Whoa!
His shot missed her.
Die!
This time, the bullet grazed her arm. Annja felt as if an open flame had been put to her skin. She slipped by the three men surrounding her and raced toward the one-eyed gunman. She darted left when he brought the gun up again. The sword was in her hand. The combination of his surprise and the sword's impact on his hand sent the gun tumbling from his grip. Annja spun. She brought the flat of the blade around again, striking him in the arm. She cuffed the one-eyed man on the neck and rendered him unconscious. Annja turned to face the remaining three. And then the one with the chain lashed her chest. She doubled over, still managing to point the sword at him. He doggedly whipped the chain at her again and caught the blade. Annja sliced down with the sword, using just enough force to wound him, but not cut off his arm.
Enough!
He grasped his bleeding arm and held it close. Behind him, the others took off running. Annja realized they'd been the same two who had run away at the beginning and come back with reinforcements. Would they return with still more?
Enough! I give up!
Annja willed the sword away, and despite her pain, shoved the man toward the wall. In the shadows there, Annja found her purse, which she had dropped when she'd picked the fight with the first youth. She grabbed it, took her cell phone out, and called the police.
I'm at Gare du Nord. I've just been accosted by a Roma gang. No, I'm all right. Some vigilantes came to my aid. Yes, thank you.
Well, it was half true. Prodding the man to stay ahead of her, Annja nudged him toward her shoes, which she gingerly put on. Then she directed him to sit near one of his fallen fellows.
Wait for the police.
When she heard the sirens, she returned to the shadows, following the wall back to the old train station, and toward where she had earlier sensed someone else watching her.
Rue.
You're hurt.
I'll heal.
Rather quickly, no doubt. And what was all of that for, Annja Creed?
As the wail of the sirens grew louder, Annja glanced toward the men, making sure none of them had bolted. She touched her arm, feeling the sting from the bullet and the warmth of her blood. There was a first aid kit in her suitcase at the hotel. She always traveled with one. Annja and Rue kept close to the front of the massive Gare du Nord. The original train station had been demolished a century and a half ago, deemed too small. This huge affair, built in its place, was one of Anya's favorite places in Paris. Its facade was created around a triumphal arch, the main cast-iron support beams supplied by an ironworks in Glasgow. In daylight, you could see eight statues along the building's cornice, each representing international destinations: London, Brussels, Vienna, Warsaw, Frankfurt, Amsterdam, Berlin, Cologne. Well past midnight now, there were a few souls about, some gaping down the street in the direction of the downed gang. From the cover of their vantage point, Annja and Rue watched as a police car arrived, its flashing ice-blue lights cutting through the thinning fog. A van pulled in behind it, and policemen spilled out. Like swarming ants, they took control of the Romanys, lifting the unconscious forms and handcuffing the older one. Annja couldn't hear what they were saying, but the older man pointed with his head toward the shadows and the train station. Annja started to move again as fast as she dared without drawing attention. She pulled Rue along with her. They reached the far end of the station and turned the corner.
Didn't want to stick around and explain yourself to the police?
I'll be in France for the better part of another week.
More than enough time for you to pick another fight with the Romani gangs. Getting more underground footage for your television program?
I'm done in the catacombs. I leave tomorrow. Later today, actually, for Avignon.
A vacation? It would certainly be long overdue. Or are you working on another episode of Chasing Historical Monsters?
Chasing History's Monsters. And yes, that's why I'm going to Avignon. My producer is being cost-conscious. Doug figures if he's sending a crew to France, he may as well get several segments out of it. So we did the tunnels under Paris.
And what lies under Avignon? Just making conversation, Annja.
The Cynocephalus and St. Christopher.
The what?
Old man, you don't know about St. Christopher and the legend of the Cynocephalus?
Sorry, no.
Cynocephali are said to be dog-headed men. They come up in a lot of anecdotal accounts of history. Centuries back, they supposedly sent a delegation to the Pope in Avignon. Some of the medieval legends paint St. Christopher as one of the Cynocephali.
Fascinating.
In any event, my producer found a posting on the internet that some dog-headed men were spotted by tourists in Avignon a few weeks ago.
Probably some costumed youths.
Or real dogs, transformed by Photoshop.
Beautiful place, Avignon. The city of the popes in the 13 and 1400s.
The Catholic schism. I've visited Avignon before, and I don't get tired of it. One of the few cities in France to have maintained its ramparts and Rocher des Dons.
And the bridge of Avignon, on the left bank of the Rhône. And the place where Annja Creed will chase her next historical monster.
Rue pivoted to stand in front of her, his pale blue eyes peering into her green ones.
Be careful, Annja, that an historical monster does not come chasing you.
Sarah drove a 2005 Peugeot 607, four-door gunmetal gray. It didn't look like anything special. Because it was a manual, she was at the wheel rather than her passenger, who was in charge of this foray. The Peugeot handled a little stiffly. Sarah preferred smaller, splashier sports cars, but they'd needed something as unnoticeable as possible. Arshar sat next to her in the passenger seat. He wasn't that old. In his late 30s, maybe 40, tops, Sarah guessed, which put him at about twice her age. Her window was down, and she had the vent going full blast to cut the reek of smoke left from previous drivers. Arshar didn't seem bothered by the smell.
Do you smoke?
Slow down. Wouldn't want to get in an accident. Or a speeding ticket.
Of course, Arshar. But next time we rent an automatic and you drive. I'm tired of your constant directions.
Arshar had been at her since they'd left Paris, suggesting when she should change lanes and which turnoffs to take. He'd picked the route. He was more familiar with this part of France, but that didn't mean his constant corrections were any less annoying. It was enough that Sarah sometimes heard voices in her head, voices that had told her to take this trip with Arshar. She didn't need him talking, too. It was nearing noon when they reached Rocamadour. She'd wanted to stop well outside of the town and come in after dark, but Arshar had insisted they arrive early.
Being ahead of schedule is always best. It allows for the unexpected, and it lets us look around.
Sarah knew better than to argue. Arshar was one of Lawton's senior knights, and at the moment she was just a lackey. With luck, though, and a good performance today, that would change.
Park in the lower city.
I've been here before.
It was a lie, but what did that little one matter? Besides, the place had a population of less than 1,000, so how hard could it be to find her way around?
Give me a minute and I'll find a good spot.
When were you here?
She ducked the question by pulling into a small lot.
Quaint.
Or worse than quaint. Sarah loved Paris. So busy, lively, colorful, loud. This was anything but. Perched on a rocky plateau that overlooked the Alzou Valley, the town was known for its incredible views and historical religious sites.
So why way down here?
For a handful of hours, we are sightseers, Sarah. Enjoying the weather, taking a tour, stopping for lunch.
She let him steer her to the second floor of the Envie de Terroir. They took a table by the window. It was a little large for just the two of them, but it was away from the other diners, and they could talk without being overheard. Arshar ordered the lunch special for them, ventrèche, tomato tartine, and glasses of wine.
I'm surprised you're drinking. More that you're letting me drink.
We'll walk it off long before tonight.
Later, he ordered a second glass, and Sarah was quick to ask for a raspberry and almond tart from the cart the waiter was pushing.
Since you're buying. Good food. Place is a little quiet, but it'll do.
Everything was a little quiet here. Arshar finished his wine and paid the bill.
More than a million tourists come here every year, Sarah. Some for the wine, most for the buildings. Pilgrims, too.
Were you one of them? A pilgrim?
That was many years ago.
How many?
I was young. Let's ride the elevator from the lower town, Basseville. We'll take the stairs tonight.
The architecture was amazing, and Sarah wished she really had been here before, so she could have taken time to properly explore. She had been enrolled as a European history major when she'd dropped out of the University of Provence-Aix-Marseille a month ago in her second semester. Her current career path was more interesting. Arshar remained silent while a few more tourists boarded the elevator and it started its ascent. A young woman in a low-cut shirt was pressed against him, but he showed no reaction.
When you were here before, Sarah, did you come for the Black Madonna, the centerpiece of Chapelle Notre Dame?
Sure. A casual tourist, you know.
Sarah had to stop lying in an effort to impress this man. She watched as the cluster of churches and chapels came into view, and then quickly stepped out of the elevator when it reached the top. Sarah and Arshar pretended to browse the souvenir shops before taking a walking tour of the Basilique Saint-Sauveur. The hours ticked by, and she found herself actually enjoying the day, until the sun started to set. They took the last elevator ride back down to the lower town, and anxiety set in. Arshar noticed.
Are you certain you're up for this, Sarah?
It's what we came here for, right? And you can't do it without me. Yes, I'm up for this. I've been looking forward to this since Dr. Lawton lectured about it.
Dinner first.
But...
We need the night, and a good meal will help pass the time. Aren't you hungry?
Dinner was at the Beau Site Géant de Vallon, and she ordered for herself this time an omelette with truffles, one of the most expensive items on the menu, and a salad. Arshar opted for the duck steak carpaccio with sliced cantaloupe. They both had a liberal amount of coffee.
So you were a pilgrim?
I studied with the Benedictine monks here, and I had the good fortune to scrub the floor of the Chapelle Miraculeuse, where the tomb of Saint Amadour is located.
And he is?
No one to concern us tonight.
Sarah shrugged and looked out the window, watching four women carrying lit candles.
So the Chapelle Miraculeuse
is not where we are going.
I know. I took courses from Dr. Lawton first semester, and...
That makes you an expert, eh?
Is it dark enough yet?
Yes, but not late enough. Patience, Sarah. Patience is...
A virtue.
They got candles out of the trunk of the rental car and joined a small procession, climbing up the Grand Escalier, a weathered stone stairway to the chapels they'd toured earlier in the day. Sarah counted the steps. 216. No wonder they'd taken the elevator the first time. The climb wasn't taxing to her, though. In fact, Sarah wished the people in front of them would walk faster. They paused at each of the 14 stations of the cross until they reached the Cross of Jerusalem at the top. Contrary to Sarah's expectations, Arshar showed no sign of fatigue. The same could not be said for some of the tourists who had ascended with them.
When you came here on a pilgrimage...
I took the stairs on my knees, as is customary when seeking penance.
Tough on your pants, I'll bet.
This is a holy place. Your footsteps will fall on stones touched by Zacchaeus of Jericho, Saint Dominique, Saint Bernard, perhaps even Charlemagne, when he prepared to fight the Spanish Moors. Miracles happen here. Healings, conversions. Do not mock this place.
Sorry.
The buildings looked different in the dark. The Romanesque Gothic style made eerie in the flickering light from the candles and the pale glow that spilled from a few windows. Sarah and Arshar mingled with the tourists, many of them praying softly, their voices lost in the strains of a chant coming from the nearest chapel. Arshar prayed too, though Sarah couldn't hear him. She just noticed his lips moving and his thumbs rubbing against the base of his candle. Sarah hadn't been to church since she'd lived with her parents in Delaware, but she wasn't irreligious. Deciding that it would be appropriate to copy the others, and that God might actually pay attention here, Sarah bowed her head and prayed that she wouldn't screw up. An hour later, she and Arshar tossed their candles and hid in an alcove of the Basilique Saint-Sauveur, where they waited until the last tourist left. Sarah guessed that it was early morning, maybe 2 or 3, judging by how tired she was. The buzz from the coffee had worn off a while ago.
I'll see to security. In a few minutes, I'll meet you inside the chapelle.
Sarah counted to 100, then glided next door to the Chapelle Notre-Dame. Arshar said there was security, and she had no doubt it was high-tech, though decidedly out of place in the old buildings. The Black Madonna, which she'd read about in a tourist pamphlet in one of the souvenir shops, was the focal point of this building. Hopefully, the bulk of the security efforts were tied to the Madonna. Sarah waited for a second count of 100. Still no Arshar.
Great.
So far, she'd done nothing illegal. She could hightail it out of here and go back to her studio apartment on Avenue Georges V.
This is your destiny.
Instead, Sarah went through the arch. No alarms went off. Sarah pulled a tiny flashlight out of her pocket, cupped her hand over the top, and aimed it around until she found what she was looking for. Then she switched the light off, tiptoed to the wall, and took off her shoes. She didn't want her rubber soles marring the wall or squeaking. She tugged a pair of tight-fitting gloves out of her pocket and wiggled into them, though she wasn't especially worried about leaving fingerprints. She'd never been in trouble before. Still, it was a precaution.
Where is Urshar?
She felt along the wall and found the natural cracks in the stonework. Wedging her fingers in, she slowly pulled herself up. The muscles in her arms bunched and her chest tightened.
Nerves.
Sarah thought of the chant she'd listened to earlier. The sound had been soothing.
Relax.
She pulled herself higher, relying only on her handholds, her feet spread in a ballet dancer's second position against the stone.
Relax.
Sarah felt a ledge and gripped it. The pain in her fingers helped her focus. A little higher, and there was a second ledge, which she pulled herself onto, resting her knees. Finding a good handhold, she leaned backward, one arm outstretched, fingers searching, searching, finding a beam. Sarah wrapped her arms and legs around it and inched out upside down.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.